The mountain wind screams across the knife edge ridge, high in the Andes. Drop a stone over these precipices and you'll wait several seconds before hearing it strike. If you hear it at all, over the constant Andean gales that make shouting necessary even at arm's length. A single misstep here means plummeting thousands of feet to your death. Yet 500 years ago, entire work crews built architectural masterpieces on these vertical cliff faces. They had no iron tools, no wheels, no written blueprints, no modern safety equipment, just stone tools, grass ropes, and human ingenuity. Modern construction crews with cranes, steel cables, and safety harnesses still struggle to build on terrain like this. So how did the Incas construct massive stone cities on impossible cliff faces while maintaining remarkably low casualty rates? The key appears to have been a revolutionary principle. When gravity tries to kill you, make gravity work for you instead. This approach guided every aspect of Inca cliff construction, from site planning to final completion. Rather than fighting against vertical drops, howling winds, and unstable surfaces, they harnessed these forces for construction advantage. Before a single stone was cut, Inca engineers had to solve the fundamental challenge. How do you even reach impossible cliff sites safely, let alone build on them? The solution lay in their transportation network that turned death-defying terrain into manageable construction zones. The Chapak Nyan, the Great Inca Trail, crossed deep valleys using suspension bridges that supported llama caravans and military units hundreds of feet above roaring rivers. Picture yourself standing at the edge of these canyons, feeling the vibration of rushing water through the rock beneath your feet, watching the mist rise from rapids so far below, they appear as white threads against black stone. The Cueswachaca Bridge in Peru demonstrates this perfectly. This last surviving Inca rope bridge spans the Apurimac River Canyon and has been rebuilt annually for centuries using traditional techniques that reveal the original construction process. Contemporary sources describe it being rebuilt in just days by local communities working simultaneously from both sides of the canyon, their voices echoing across the void as they coordinate movements with ancestral precision. These bridges required accounting for wind loads that could send a person tumbling into the abyss, seasonal weather changes that turned rope fibers brittle, and varying weights from military columns to laden llama trains crossing single file across swaying spans. The fiber technology required understanding tension, elasticity, and load distribution that appears remarkably sophisticated for its time period. Analysis shows Inca rope makers created specialized load-bearing cables with different fiber compositions for specific applications. Ropes that felt different in your hands. Some stiff for structural support, others flexible for safety lines. Load-bearing bridge cables use different grass combinations than safety lines, reflecting sophisticated understanding of material properties under stress. Each rope was likely tested under controlled loads before use in cliff environments where failure meant worker deaths. Imagine the tension as workers tested each strand, knowing their lives would depend on this woven grass holding firm over empty space. Once access was established, the incredible breakthrough was their terracing system, which essentially converted deadly vertical drops into stable, horizontal work platforms. Stand at Machu Picchu today, and you can feel how each level provides solid footing beneath your feet. No longer are you dependent on ropes over a void, where equipment failure means certain death. Modern mountaineers and construction workers still use this principle when working on cliff faces. Create stable platforms rather than depending entirely on ropes over open space. The physics of this approach were brilliant, but imagine the scale of excavation required. Workers had to carve backwards into solid mountainsides, hauling countless tons of rock debris along narrow paths where a single overloaded llama could trigger a deadly avalanche. At Machu Picchu, this system transforms an unbuildable steep mountainside into stable construction platforms where you can hear your footsteps echo off stone instead of disappearing into empty air. Each terrace level provided secure footing for construction crews while serving as permanent structural support for the buildings above. Workers could build walls while standing on solid, level surfaces, feeling granite bedrock beneath their feet instead of depending on rope systems over precipices where the sound of falling rocks takes seconds to fade. Studies at the site suggest these terraces solved multiple life-threatening challenges simultaneously, providing stable platforms that wouldn't collapse under worker weight, managing water drainage to prevent catastrophic landslides, and creating agricultural space for food production, all while integrating architecturally with temple and residential complexes. Investigations indicate building Machu Picchu's terrace system required coordinated work by hundreds of people over several years. Construction likely began during dry seasons when soil conditions were stable enough for safe excavation work, when workers could distinguish between solid ground and loose material that might give way underfoot. And this reveals the true genius of Inca planning. They understood that water management wasn't just convenience, it was survival. Picture the sound of heavy rainfall drumming against stone, the site of previously dry gullies suddenly torrenting with runoff that could undermine terrace foundations in minutes. Any mountaineer will tell you that water-saturated ground on cliff faces can shift from stable to deadly in hours, turning what seemed like secure footing into landslides that kill everyone in the path. Rain, snow runoff, and groundwater can quickly transform stable clifftop construction sites into muddy death traps, where every step becomes uncertain. The Incas address this through hydraulic engineering that rivals modern cliff stabilization techniques. At Machu Picchu, they installed sophisticated drainage channeling water through the city via a carefully calculated series of fountains, each flowing into the next with the musical sound of controlled water flow. A stark contrast to the destructive roar of unmanaged runoff during storms. Calculations by water engineer Kenneth Wright show that the fountain system maintains consistent water pressure across elevation changes. Wright's analysis demonstrates that the system could move more than 300 litres of water per minute, and after 500 years, these channels still function exactly as designed. You can still hear the gentle splash of water moving through carved stone channels that have outlasted civilizations. The hydraulic calculations demonstrate advanced mathematical understanding. The channel that brings water to Machu Picchu is 750 meters long, 12 centimeters deep, and 15 centimeters wide. For every 100 meters of distance traveled, it descends 10 meters, so that gravity could maintain a flow of 300 liters per minute, a constant, reassuring sound that meant safety rather than destruction. The terraces incorporated these drainage systems that channel water safely away from construction areas, preventing the saturated soil conditions that cause landslides, a deadly threat that could turn stable ground into a killing zone within hours. Now, let me take you to where Inca engineering reaches its most sophisticated level, a breakthrough that fundamentally changed what was possible in extreme terrain construction. What stunned researchers was discovering the Incas worked stone directly on construction sites, rather than quarrying massive blocks elsewhere and hauling them up cliff faces. Imagine the bone-jarring effort of dragging multi-ton granite blocks up switchback trails where a broken rope or stumbled footing sends everything crashing into the void below. This decision alone likely prevented accidents where one wrong step means falling thousands of feet. When you're working on a cliff face where the wind never stops and your hands grow numb from the cold, every design choice becomes a life or death decision. The famous precision of Inca stonework wasn't just aesthetic, it was crucial for safety. Picture workers balancing on narrow ledges, chiseling joints so perfect that 5 centuries later, you still can't slip a knife blade between the stones. When blocks fit so perfectly that mortar wasn't necessary, construction crews didn't need repeated dangerous adjustments while balancing multi-ton stones over cliff edges, where a single miscalculation meant death for everyone below. Analysis by architect-archaeologist Vincent Lee at sites like ollantaytambo shows evidence that the Incas used specialized local quarrying methods to achieve these perfect fits. Rather than brute force that would require dangerous heavy lifting over precipices, they employed systematic stone shaping methods that prioritize precision over speed. Research indicates the technique involves understanding rock grain patterns and natural fracture lines. The subtle differences in granite texture that reveal where stone will split cleanly versus where it will shatter into unusable fragments. workers would study each stone's internal structure, identifying where to place bronze wedges and apply pressure to achieve desired shapes without multiple dangerous repositioning attempts on unstable cliffside surfaces. Here's where the sophistication becomes truly apparent. The Incas developed specialized tools designed specifically for cliff construction safety. Picture bronze crowbars and wedges designed with extended handles that provided leverage while keeping workers away from cliff edges. Tools you could grip firmly even with hands stiff from cold, designed so that the force of your swing wouldn't pull you off balance on narrow ledges. Stone hammers incorporated balance features that may have prevented slips during repetitive striking motions on precarious surfaces. Building safely on precipices isn't just about engineering, it's about coordination in environments where communication errors kill instantly. Imagine coordinating the movements of dozens of workers carrying multi-ton stones across narrow cliff edge paths while fierce Andean winds make verbal commands nearly impossible to hear, where hand signals become the difference between success and catastrophe. Discoveries at construction sites suggest organizational methods that may have dramatically reduced worker accidents during extreme altitude projects. While specific safety records cannot be verified from this time period, some historical accounts describe remarkably orderly work sites, despite involving thousands of workers on precipitous terrain, where you could hear the echo of shouted instructions bouncing off canyon walls. All cliffside work appears to have been organized around the Ailu kinship system, extended family groups that had worked together for generations and could instinctively coordinate movements where split-second timing meant life or death. Picture brothers and cousins moving in perfect synchronization, each knowing exactly when the others would step, when to lift, when to secure ropes. Muscle memory developed over lifetimes where hesitation could be fatal. Findings suggest systematic training protocols that likely prioritize safety. Young workers may have spent years learning stone cutting and rope work techniques in safe valley locations before approaching cliff construction sites, developing the calloused hands and steady balance essential for extreme altitude work. The training system appears to have followed strict hierarchies based on experience and skill level. Excavations indicate novice workers handled material preparation in safe areas where mistakes meant dropped tools rather than dropped lives, while master craftsmen performed the most dangerous cliff edge work. Studies demonstrate the ceremonial calendar that coordinated construction activities also functioned as weather-based safety protocol, synchronizing work schedules with seasonal patterns to avoid construction during high winds that could knock workers from ledges, heavy rains that turned stone slippery, or temperature extremes that made cliff work extremely dangerous. The rope manufacturing process appears to have involved quality control measures that prevented equipment failures during construction. Rather than using standard stone working implements that might require dangerous body positions on unstable surfaces, they created tools that allowed workers to maintain secure footing while achieving precise cuts. The entire system worked because each phase built upon the previous one. Stable terraces provided platforms for precision stone cutting. Integrated drainage prevented the water damage that could undermine months of work. Systematic training ensured workers could execute complex maneuvers safely. Quality controlled materials meant equipment wouldn't fail at critical moments. Each stone appears to have been shaped to fit exactly once, eliminating precarious trial and error positioning on unstable surfaces where there was no margin for error. This wasn't just technical innovation. It was strategic safety planning that minimized the most hazardous aspects of cliff building while maintaining reasonable safety margins for workers in environments where mistakes were fatal. The Incas achieved something remarkable. They developed systematic methodologies that made building on terrain that should have killed them seem routine through careful integration of engineering, organization, and sophisticated safety systems. Their cliff construction wasn't desperate improvisation, it was sophisticated methodology that converted deadly challenges into manageable procedures through principles modern extreme environment workers rely on today. By following this logical construction sequence, establishing access, creating stable platforms, managing water, preparing materials on site, organizing experienced teams, and maintaining quality control, they created a system that minimised extreme terrain building dangers while achieving architectural goals that seem impossible today. We still struggle to build safely on extreme terrain with modern equipment and safety regulations. Yet the Incas developed systematic solutions using grass ropes and stone tools that kept workers alive on projects that should have been impossible. The principles of harnessing environmental challenges, developing systematic safety protocols, and integrating human organization with technical innovation remain as relevant today as they were five centuries ago on the knife-edge ridges of the Andes. What strikes you most about how the Incas turned deadly challenges into construction advantages? Was it their ability to work stone so precisely that workers never had to make dangerous adjustments on cliff edges? Their terracing systems that converted vertical death traps into stable work platforms? Or their family-based teams that could coordinate complex movements where a single mistake meant falling thousands of feet? If you found this exploration of ancient engineering fascinating, you might enjoy learning about how other civilizations solve seemingly impossible challenges that still defy engineering today.